organic agriculture. We tried to understand organic agriculture. Different definitions were discussed, and also you could see different variants of organic farming. There are long number, and you remember the CHEF, CHEF principles of organic farming. And we also seen the differences in conventional and organic farming. There are certain points, particularly yield, economics, and environment, and biodiversity, etc., on the basis of which we can make distinction between conventional and organic farming. And these are description of differences in conventional and organic farming, seen the status of world organic agriculture. And we can see that there were 187 countries, Australia having 35.7 million hectare area, or that is cultivated area. So leading country, and we have seen some other data. You can see again 35.7 million hectare in Australia. And then Liechtenstein is the country which has 41% area covered under organic agriculture. India has distinction of having largest number of farmer, or over 13 lakhs. You can say 13.7 lakhs farmers are there. This large number indicate that most of the organic farmers are small holders. And USA has the largest market of organic products, and highest per capita consumption is in Denmark, and closely followed by Switzerland. And Finland has largest wild collection in the world area. This is area. And this is about India. The latest data you can see. In India, there is about 2.65 million hectare cultivated area and 1.68 million hectare wild harvest, totaling 4.33 million hectare certified area. We then started topic why there is a need to go for organic farming, or naturally we will go for alternative when the existing alternative is not good. When we have problem with the existing farming, when we have issues with the modern farming or chemical farming, then we need to find out alternative. And one alternative could be organic farming. So we need organic farming because the conventional farming is having number of constraints, number of issues, number of problems. So first problem of conventional agriculture was decline in factor productivity. We know what are the factors of production: land, labor, capital, and management. These are the four factors of production. And land has very wide meaning. Land does not mean just your soil. It includes your water, natural water, sunlight, etc. So land has your air. Air is also natural resource, so that will come under land. Labor, you know, capital you need to buy some inputs, buy your buy manure, buy seed, buy some other inputs, you need capital. And then management is mostly done by the farmer. So productivity of these factors is declining, and I have described you. Unsafe food, I will show you how this unsafe food is compelling many people to look for some alternative food, reduce biodiversity, decrease quality of soil, water, air, leading to environmental pollution, global warming, and finally climate change. And we know partly this conventional farming is responsible for climate changes, particularly emission of greenhouse gases and the use of pesticides, fertilizer, etc. So organic farming could be one of the option. Here I wish to say you that it is not the only option. One can go for other kind of option like ICM. One can go for ICM, integrated crop management, where you need not to apply too much of fertilizer. You can adopt integrated approaches, or you can go for horticultural production, convert your cropping area to high value crops. And there are number of options, and one option could be organic farming. So many times people here get confused that if we convert all kind of our agricultural or conventional farming to organic farming, then food security will be an issue. we will not have sufficient food. So that is just a kind of a wrong notion. People are misleading other people by saying like this. They are actually opponents of organic farming. They oppose organic farming, and that is the best reason, because nobody is going to certify their statements. So actually, policy is that convert the only the selected pockets in the country to organic farming. Nobody is saying that you convert the whole farming to organic farming. Certain areas which are already very close to organic farming, rain-fed area, hilly area, where there is minimum use of pesticide, fertilizer, they can be easily converted to organic farming, and their yield will be close to conventional yields. So in organic farming, just keep in mind that only a small area can be converted to organic farming, not the whole area of the country. You get about 143 or 142 million hectares of cultivated area in the country, and out of which now just I have shown you data, about 2.5 or 2.3 million hectares is in organic farm. So if out of 142, if you even make 5 million hectares under organic farming, cultivated organic farming, then you will not lose your food security. We are already food secure. Too much of food is wasted. I need not to tell you the story that our food, our wheat, our rice, our pulses get decomposed on railway station, get decomposed on roads. You must have seen many pictures in newspaper or in your television or anywhere. You can see that a lot of food is wasted in India. So food security is not an issue actually. So overall, the message is, seeing all these weaknesses of conventional farming, one would say that let us have some alternative, and organic farming has potential to partly substitute the conventional farming. And this was also discussed, I think, the decline in factor productivity, unsafe food, and reduced nutritional quality, climate change, and reduced soil fertility are the reason for reduced nutritional quality. I will discuss in detail. Now the next topic for today starts here, food quality. So now why I have taken this topic, food quality, because consumer is a person who is spending the money, and he need whatever money he is spending, he need that money, means the food of that quantity of money. He want good food if he is spending good money. If he is spending money on organic food, then if it is good in food quality, then only consumer will be interested. If the food quality of conventional product and organic product is same, why he will invest extra money on organic food? Last time you have seen the difference in prices, at least 3 to 4 times higher prices of organic products were researched by you. So why expensive food a consumer will buy unless there is some qualitative things in the organic food? It is rich in nutritional quality. So before going into detail, quality, can you define the quality? Anybody can explain the meaning of, just meaning of quality. What do we mean by quality? Hello? Anyone can come forward and give your idea about quality. What is quality? Many times you say, I need a quality shirt, I need a quality pen, I need a quality teacher, I need a quality watch. So what does it mean? What is meant by quality? Are you listening to me, dear?
I think it's choice of supreme.
Choice of?
Supreme or consummate, but that means peak level, which you can choose.
Yeah, definitely. It means quality is certain attributes, some certain attributes in a commodity or in a material or in a thing which have relative value. Relative value, that is the quality. Means the relative, how to say it, relative maybe appearance, relative taste, relative appeal or something like that. So you cannot, generally you cannot quantify the quality. It is relative. Quality is always relative. As somebody said that beauty lies in the eyes of the holder, beholder. So your eyes will decide that a particular item has good quality or bad quality. So that is just by appearance, just by your, you see it or you observe it, you feel it. That is a quality in one aspect. In other aspect, it can be the composition. Composition means nutritionally, if a particular crop or particular thing has more protein, then I can say, okay, it has good quality. If something has more unsaturated fat in seed, then I can say it is better quality. So sometimes quality can be measured in respect of certain attributes. So definitely quality varies with the individual. For example, somebody would like red apple. Apple comes in 3-4 colors. Green color, yellow color, golden color. Number of colors are there. For mango also, you got different color, yellow color, red color, green color. In chilies, you must have seen this Shimla mirch, you know, Shimla mirch capsicum. It comes in 3 colors, green, yellow, red. So likewise, to me, red capsicum may be good or may have better quality because I may like it because of red color. But somebody else will like yellow color. Somebody else will say, no, for me, green color is good. He has not seen the composition, but it is just by physical appearance, some people can decide the quality. But just by color, some go by the size. For example, your tomato or potato, if they are too big or carrots are too big, not many people will like them. If they are too small, again, people will not like. So generally, people prefer medium size. And also, again, most of the people will prefer medium size. But still, you will find some person who will like the smaller size. So for him or her, small size of potato or tomato may be of good quality. So just by size, sometimes people decide. Some people want to buy the rotten food. Somebody, I have seen one of our teacher who will go to market and he will buy the partly rotten vegetables or vegetables which used to have diseases, infected by some diseases, some black spots, some discoloration or some insect infection. You must have seen your brinjal. In brinjal, sometimes you get some borers are there. And you can easily identify the hole from which these borers enter or they go out. So he will buy the damaged vegetables. And reason was simple for him. It has good quality because it is expected that such product will not have pesticides. The products which are very shining, very attractive and insect and disease free, it is very likely that those products may contain a lot of pesticides. I don't mean you eat those kind of vegetable, but I'm telling you the choice of certain people. So it is very difficult to measure the quality. But of course, we can measure the nutritional quality of the things. So here we restrict only to the nutritional quality. So many times people say that organic products have better quality, better nutritional quality. And some people have made studies where they have proved that there is no difference in quality, nutritional quality of organic products and conventional product. But now, conclusively, many people have said that organic products have better quality than conventional product. Here, from this point onward, you remember, quality means nutritional quality. So Robert McCarrison was the first, he established nutritional research laboratory in Kunnur, Nilgiri district in Tamil Nadu. I have already told you in the history part, Robert McCarrison was a doctor in army and kind of scientist also. So he studied relationship among soil fertility, food quality, and human nutrition. And he has come out with the conclusion that addition of fertilizer or mineral fertilizer decreases the food quality. So for details, we need to see his paper, what constituted the food quality for him. But overall, he concluded that application of fertilizer reduces food quality. And similarly, I have shown you in the history part that Albert Howard has said that health of the soil is linked to plants and plant health is linked to animal and human health. So there is one National Institute of Nutrition, NIN Hyderabad, which is a government institute, and they have made studies on Indian foods, composition of Indian foods in several decades. First time they started in 1937, and the latest one was in 2017. So they have said that Indian foods are declining in quality, nutritional quality. So now this National Institute of Nutrition, they have made a study of composition of Indian food. First time they have made Indian food composition tables in 1937, then 1951, then 1971, and 1989, and the recent one is 2017. So what they did, they analyzed all kind of food, like your beans, your milk, your meat, vegetables, all sorts of food items. Their composition means their carbohydrate, proteins, fat, lipids, or your vitamins, minerals, all food constituents were analyzed, and about 28 years, from 1989 to 2017, in the 28 years period, what happened in this 28 year period between 1989 and 2017, carbohydrate in bajra declined by 8.5%. In whole wheat, carbohydrate declined by 9%. Protein declined by 10.4% in lentil and 6.12% in moong. In potato, thiamine, vitamin B1 declined, magnesium declined, and zinc also declined. In ripe tomatoes, thiamine, iron, and zinc declined by 66% to 73%. Iron declined by 76.6% in green tomato, and in apple, 60% of the iron declined. Now you see, people used to eat apples for iron, and there is 60% reduction in the iron content, what we were having 28 years before. You may take it in joke, but it is a serious matter. So suppose protein declined by 10%, that means suppose it was 25% protein in lentil, then you multiply it by 10, divide by 100. So there is about 2.5% decline. So that is why now it may have 22.5% protein, lentil. So that is the meaning of decline. So this is a very serious, and what will happen? First, you see the data. Data is available for all the commodities. It is published in Down to Earth on 28 February. So you can see this percentage change from 1989 level. So in wheat, for example, protein minus 17.26% change. So minus means reduction. So you can see later I have shared this presentation. So overall, you can see there are changes or reduction in protein, carbohydrate, or fat, or vitamins, minerals, iron, zinc, etc. So now you will ask me, sir, why this decline has happened? What are the reasons for decline in nutritional composition of Indian food? So now you see, if your soil is deficient in micronutrient or any nutrient, then your plant will naturally have the deficiency. If our soils are 43% deficient in zinc. Many people say 50% soils or Indian soils are deficient in zinc. Then how come your plant will have sufficient zinc? And suppose this zinc deficiency is there, so it can affect protein synthesis also. So as such, the concentration of zinc will be low in the plant or plant foods. And further, this deficiency of zinc may lead to deficiency of other constituent. I do not know exact role of zinc, but just assume that this zinc may be useful in protein synthesis or RNA synthesis. Suppose if it is useful in other biochemical or biosynthesis of other compounds in the plant, then that kind of product will also be less. Suppose it affects your it is involved in the synthesis of indole acetic acid, I think, zinc. So the role of that hormone in growth will be affected. So overall, you can see deficiency of micronutrients is quite frequent in Indian soils. And because of this, there may be deficiency in the food. And if you see, I just ask you one question. There is one cow, or two cows are there. One cow is grazing in the wild. She is grazing in the field or grasslands. And one cow is staying in the home. And she is stall feeding. People are feeding in home. It is called as stall feeding. And same material is fed. What kind of things or same kind of fodder is fed? So which cow will be more happy and which cow will generally give a better quality milk?
Which cow? Grazing.
Grazing cow. First thing is that when she is going to wild, she will get great variety of food. Great variety of food in grassland. She may have legumes, she may have grass. In grasses, she can eat 2-3 different kind of grasses. Similarly, 2-3 different kind of legumes and maybe non-legumes. And so that cow has opportunity to eat variety of food and that will result in balanced nutrition. And the cow which is being fed in home, it may get one or two or three kind of fodder materials. So that fodder material may be deficient in one or two amino acid, maybe in fatty acid, maybe in some minerals, etc. So the scope is limited there. So similarly, a soil, for her, the food was good. Food was good means she ate. And she was also happy also, you see. She was walking, she was doing exercise also during grazing. So partly, she's happy also. If you chain an animal, you're putting in the chain this animal in home, then she will never be happy. She's not moving. She's not really happy. You have just imprisoned her. You have just jailed her. So for the time being, this grassland cow will have some freedom. So there are so many things. And ultimately, quality of the milk is better there in the grazing cow. So similarly, because the grass or other food were rich in nutrients. Similarly here, if your soil is not having variety of products, variety of nutrients, and their sufficient levels, then your food will contain poor status of nutrients. So quality will be poor. This is one reason. Number two, people subscribe the view that climate change can also result in reduced food quality, particularly content of minerals and vitamins in your food. So, for example, such studies have been made under protected environment, under under polythene, you can say, greenhouses. So wheat grown in high CO2 level. So then people found that 9.3% less zinc, 5.1% less iron, and 6.3% less protein. That means there was some dilution effect because CO2 level rise means your photosynthesis will be fast or more, and this will have more synthesis of carbohydrates. And in relation to carbohydrate, the proportion, the content of other nutrients will be diluted. So that is another reason. Therefore, they said that rice, in case of rice, there was 5.2% less iron, 3.3% less zinc and 7.8% less protein. So you can see the in the environment, our environment in the maybe in the 28 years from 1989 to 2017, there may be differences in the carbon dioxide levels. So because of that, there may be dilution. So these are the two reasons for decline in food quality. Do you have any point of discussion or anything you want to add or anything you want to clarify? You are welcome. Yeah, not yet. Okay. So now, what will be the result of if I am eating less protein, less food, and the quantity of food is fixed? Suppose in one day I am eating these days 200 gram food or 300 gram food all the day. Or suppose I eat just 10 chapati in a day. I eat a fixed quantity of rice and fixed quantity of chapati. Then what will happen? I will be short of nutrients because the total weight, the quantity of the food, my food is same for several days, several years. So what is happening? I am getting less and less nutrients. I'm getting the quantity same, but because the protein content, iron content, or these nutritional value has declined, I'm eating the same food, but I may have deficiency also. So these kind of things are linked to each other. Now, suppose apple, 60% decline in iron. That means I was getting sufficient iron by eating just one apple. Now I need to eat two apples to get the same level of iron. So that is the meaning. So what has happened over the years, the health of people has declined in India. There are no authentic data. But we can see there are no authentic data linking food quality to the human health in India. But we can have some idea about the health of people in India. So you can see 7 in 10 Indians have poor muscle health. And the reason is low protein levels. Because as you know, in India, most of the people depend on pulses for their protein. And of course, there are people who eat the meat also, and their protein requirement is completed by meat. But meat is also not regular in India. Those who eat the meat, maybe they are not eating sufficient meat to fulfill their protein requirement. So that is why still Indian people are short of protein. So you can see Indians are neglecting their muscle health and falling short of the recommended daily intake of protein. A survey conducted by InBody and in IPSOS of 1243 Indian between 30-55 across 8 cities found most Indians are not making enough room in their lifestyle or diets to take adequate care of muscle. So overall, you can see diet is also linked to your health or health of the muscle protein. So further, you can see that organic products are good for reducing the risk of cancer. There are many studies which say that these foods are rich in antioxidants. I will discuss later. And they contain more vitamins, proteins. And particularly, I have shown you one example where vitamin B12, I think, was there in Khubani. Khubani, or I forgot English name of Khubani. So apricot. So it was rich in vitamin B12, and those people did not have cancer, do not have any cancer. So that is for sure that if you eat healthy food, it will give you good health, and good health means less disease. There is no doubt about it. And if I eat food which is produced in the river beds, which is produced near the nalas, the dirty water is used for growing any food, that will definitely harm me. So there are not many studies have been done in Europe, America, and some other countries where they found that organic foods reduces risk of cancer. So that means quality of the food is good. Therefore, they can protect you against the diseases. And see, it was just a nutritional quality from one perspective. Okay, sometimes you can say, there's no difference in quality of organic product and conventional product. However, there is difference. But assume there is no difference. Then what about the pesticide? What about the safety? One is quality, other is safety. Safety means your food product is free from pesticides. It is free from toxic things. That is your safe food. So safety of the food is also there. Organic products are safe, and there is no guarantee that conventional product will be safe. So this was very old study in 2013. It was conducted, and it proved that you can go through this slide. You can understand. I just give the message of this slide. The message is that banned pesticides are still common. Banned pesticide means DDT, BSC. Even your generation may not have heard name of these pesticides. DDT was the first insecticide or pesticide synthesized. So DDT was more dangerous. Therefore, it was banned. But still, there residues of DDT and BSC are there. Benzene hexachloride, BHC. So they are very dangerous, and that too from the permissible limit. They are many times 800 times more, or 860 times more, or 95 times more, or so. What I mean to say is that in conventional food, you can have lot of pesticides more than the permissible limit. So just you can Google, or you can simply go to any newspaper and just type that pesticide in foods. Just type it. You'll get thousands of pages and thousands of study right in our country. And they are done by Ministry of Agriculture. You'll find that the report says that 57% sample failed, or 100% sample, milk sample, this sample. They all contain pesticide. Just see it. See it yourself. So what these pesticides can do to human beings? They can result in breakdown of nervous system, endocrine disruption, liver dysfunction, convulsion, cancer, enzyme inhibition, and kidney malfunction. So that is means your health can be deteriorated. You can be ill. You can be sick if you eat such pesticide-laden food. That is why these rich people in India, like Amitabh Bachchan, Dharmendra, you see, this Dharmendra is staying at his farm producing organic food. All the rich people of the country, they always eat organic food, and they do not trust the certified food. They really have their own farms where they are guaranteed that this is organic product. So there is no need for certification because it is for self-consumption. So those people are eating healthy food. See what will happen. This is for the common people like us, this food. And this was grown, this is a picture in some river bed. In the river, once the water, this rainy season is over, then there are certain areas in the river which are not waterlogged. So there some farmers grow vegetables. It is the case of Yamuna River perhaps. In Yamuna River, you know, this underground water and all sorts of things are polluted. In Yamuna River or any river, or no river is clean, you can say. And what he's doing, he is irrigating the crop with the same water, and finally he is washing the vegetables in the same water, and he is enriching the nutrients or enriching the pesticides further into the vegetables. So you can see what will happen to Delhi people or any, and see this, what will happen to the fish which are transported from Hyderabad to Delhi. What they do, they put some poisonous things so that these fish will not rot. So people are really very careless. They put some kind of poison material into the fish so that these fish will not decompose. I do not know the name of the material. But see, those people who are eating those fish, they can fall sick permanently also. So what I mean to say, take any case, any food. Suppose somebody is eating meat or egg or animal product or milk, whatever. If your animal is eating pesticides, if animal is eating the fodder which is grown on pesticides or grasses where people have used pesticides, so those cows and buffaloes will give you milk or meat which is already containing a lot of pesticides. So it is bound that if you do conventional farming, these pesticides will come to your body. I have seen some farmers around Delhi, they do 8 to 10 sprays of pesticide. Here, pesticide means mostly insecticide. So pesticides spray in cucumber, kheera, which is normally used in salad. So they use too many pesticides. One time I was visiting a farmer's field and he was growing the chili, mirch. And then it was somewhere the same season, July, August season, it was raining. So farmer was walking in his field. I said, you are not wearing the shoes and snakes may come. He said, no, sir, snake cannot come to my field. I asked why. He said, every third or fourth day, I spray pesticide. If you spray pesticide, the snakes will run away because they are very natural or wild animals. They don't want to see your pesticide. They don't want to smell. They don't want to smell your pesticide. They don't like it. They will run away. So see, even the illiterate snake will run away from such fields. So shocking news, you can see this is sometimes back. Pesticide content found in mother's milk, 0.12 gram of pesticide in mother's milk, which is 100 times more than the estimated amount by the WHO, means more than the residue permissible limits. In the mother's milk, it is per liter, I think, in the mother's milk. So if a child who is just born and he is drinking pesticides in the milk, what will happen to his or her health? Just think over it. Now, there are certain export items which are also affected by pesticide residues. So in basmati rice, India right now, it is earning about 30,000 crore rupees. India, 32,000. Now, this is old data. Now it is 32,000 crores of rupees are earned by India exporting basmati rice. So many times our export is affected by tricyclazole. Tricyclazole is a fungicide and many countries have reduced the maximum residue limit, MRL. So for MRL for tricyclazole for European Union, before it was 0.1 ppm. And they have reduced to 0.01 ppm. They don't want to tolerate this tricyclazole. And this tricyclazole fungicide is used to control the neck blight. Neck blast. Neck blast is a disease in rice where your panicle neck or base of the panicle is affected by fungus and it droops. And there is no grain filling. So this tricyclazole for US, they can tolerate up to 3 ppm. Japanese people can have 10 ppm tricyclazole in basmati. But even these levels, if farmers spray, are very common and our farmers, traders, industrials, they get in trouble. Your consignments of basmati are returned back to India. So that is also an issue. If you want to export basmati, let us have organic basmati and earn this money. Our exporter prefer basmati of Jammu Kashmir because in Jammu Kashmir, they use very less pesticides. Now see, not just our food, our water is also polluted across India. High levels of toxins in groundwater. In India, number of districts are 718. You can remember. People ask how many districts are there in India. So this is 2018. In 2018, there were 718 districts in India. You can see the number of districts which have problem of heavy metals and other pollutants like nitrate. 386 out of 718 districts have nitrate pollution issue in their drinking water, I think, in groundwater. Fluoride, 335 districts. Iron 301 and so on. So you try to understand the meaning. Meaning is that most of the groundwater in India is polluted by nitrate, fluoride, iron, salinity, arsenic. So many problems are there. So if you drink this water, you use it for drinking purpose and people are using, then what will happen to their health? Your food is poor, you know, food I have shown you. It is laden with pesticide. Your water is not good. Your air is not good. Then what will you do? We will see the consequences of polluted food, polluted air, polluted water. What is the consequence? The disease or cancer train means Bathinda to Bikaner. This train runs Acharya Tulsi Regional Cancer Treatment Research Center in Bikaner. So these people visit frequently, and they have unfortunately very high rates of cancer in Malwa region of Punjab. So Malwa region constitute districts like Mansa, Sangrur, Bathinda, Faridkot, Moga, Muksar, Firozpur, and Sangrur, most affected by cancer and other ailments. Not just cancer. Cancer is one case. There may be other illnesses. Now, what are the causes that people of these Malwa region suffer from cancer or other related diseases? One is unclean drinking water. So if heavy pesticide use is there, I have shown you the levels of heavy metals also. So unclean drinking water, tap water sourced from canals and which are polluted by industrial water. Groundwater also polluted. What will happen? I really appreciate efforts made by Odisha Chief Minister. I think Bhubaneswar city now you can drink the tap water. Is it so? You can drink the tap water. You don't need RO or filters there now in Bhubaneswar. Is it true?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You see the newspapers. So that means such kind of efforts are required to produce clean water. So just I want to share one story that how behind we are. When I visited UK first time in 2009, I was there for 6 months. So that time on my first day, as a smart Indian, I inquired from my professor, sir, where is drinking water? Where is drinking water? Or where is filter? Where is RO? I inquired like this, where is clean water? He said, what do you mean? For a few seconds, he could not get my meaning. Then he realized our all water is drinking water. Our all water is drinking water. They have very good drinking water. Means your tap water is drinking water. But in our country, you cannot imagine in your dreams that you can ever drink the tap water. So that is the difference in advanced countries and anyway, I appreciate efforts made by one state. And then indiscriminate or excess use of agrochemical in Punjab, especially pesticide. And other is unsafe handling of the toxic chemicals or pesticide. Unsafe handling means they don't wear masks, gloves, or all protective gears are not there. So therefore, pesticides can easily enter your body. According to one report, the people who are applying it in the field, who are doing the spray, they suffer the most. Of course, the people who are eating that food, they also suffer. But people who are applying it in the field, they suffer more than those who are eating this product. So the applicators as well as the consumers both suffer from pesticide. They can inhale it every time you are spraying, and a lot of troubles are there. Nitrate pollution, and of the 15 used, at least 7 are cancer causing. There are reports. These many pesticides are cancer causing. Now you see, that is why many youngsters, many engineers, many software engineer people, rich people, they are coming to organic farming. They are encouraging organic farming. So many people have quit the job. If you remember Sushant Singh, who was film actor, that time before his suicide or death, he was planning to grow organic foods. You know, he was just moving. So there are many examples. The great personalities or big people, they are now considering organic farming. So like in schools also, in some schools, teachers are encouraging their pupils or students to go for organic farming. Now some smart Indians or smart city people, urban people, they started growing some vegetable, maybe in a small scale, but a beginning is being made. Some people are now considering, if you go to some big bungalows or big houses in Delhi or some big cities, now those rich people, they have interest now. They have many baskets of vegetables or pots on their rooftop. Rooftop farming is gaining some attention in India now. So this is also promotion of organic farming, maybe at very small scale. So this is homegrown in pots or in small polythenes, people are growing these vegetables. So see, even in trays, you can grow some vegetables in trays also. So in poly houses, small poly houses on the rooftops. And also there is some support from the governments, different governments, state governments. So government said to develop organic farming corridor along Ganga to arrest pollution. So this was dream of Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh, I think. I don't know how much it has been happened, how much it has happened, but some news. Anybody aware of this plan of Ganga corridor? Is there any progress of plantation? They were thinking to plant some herbs or some medicinal plants, some aromatic kind of plants. Ganga corridor or something like that. I don't know. These were political promises, I think, Udo. Anyway, now the next topic is, I will finish in next 15-20 minutes. Next is that GM crops are not allowed. Genetically modified crops, I think you understand. These are transgenic plants where gene from unrelated parents or unrelated plant or animal or microbe is taken and inserted into an organism. And that is kind of borrowed gene inserted into an organism for some purpose. Purpose may be to produce antibodies, antibiotics, to produce some organic products, to produce resistance against insect pest disease or abiotic or biotic stress, any kind. So those are your GM crops. And in some countries, they are permitted GM crops. In some countries, they are not permitted. Recently, Philippines have permitted golden rice. Do you know golden rice was made to have more vitamin A, more vitamin A or carotene? So they have taken some genes from peas, green peas, they have taken the gene and they have put it into, or maybe some other plant, I forgot. Do you remember the story of golden rice? What was the source of gene that gave yellow color to the grains of rice? Yellow color of grains means it has more of carotene. So what was the source of gene for that golden rice? Anybody can tell? Can anybody tell? Was it peas or so was it some other plant?
One gene from daffodil, sir, I think.
Daffodil, you are right. Daffodil, I'm sorry, I forgot. Daffodil look like pea flower. It looked like pea flower. Maybe from daffodil. You can check it. I'm not sure, but it may be definitely daffodil. You can recheck it. So they took the gene and which produced more carotene in rice. Now it has been released in Philippines, perhaps. So, but most of the country are very, very reluctant to release these GM crops, because definitely it is anti-nature. I can prove how these GM crops are anti-nature, because the plants or animals, they also have independence, they are also free. So you cannot do anything against their wishes. Have you taken permission from rice? I want to put one gene from daffodil into you. So it is just by force. You should consider plants also as normal living things. So you should not do anything against their wish. You have not asked their wish, do you want to get a gene? So it is really against the nature. It is not a natural thing. In nature also, as a student, you must have undergone some courses on plant breeding or selection. In nature also, breeding happens, natural breeding happens, and the compatible parents, they they breed and so on. But this is not by force. It is nature. It is allowed. So this is against the nature. And there is no evidences that these GM crops will be safe to our soil. They will be safe to our environment also. So there is no guarantee. And sometimes people force others to, or they thrust their views on others. So one scientist from environmental science, Eskra, she was a lady. So she did some research on BT cotton under greenhouse condition. And she found that the roots of BT cotton release certain chemicals into the soil. And those chemicals affected the microbiology. Means microbial growth was reduced. And because of that, next time she has taken some wheat plants. She has grown wheat in that those pots, and the wheat growth was also retarded compared to control treatment. Control treatment where she has taken normal cotton. So it was proved that microbial activity was affected by BT cotton. She published that result simply as a scientist. And in the end, when the ICR could know, or people, DG director could know that that scientist has published some paper which is against the policy of BT cotton or BT crops in India. So they tried to persecute her, they tried to punish her. Of course, in the end, science prevailed, she was not punished. But these are the kind of problems scientists sometimes face. I appreciate work, that kind of work, but we need to match our research or match our science with the policy also. If it disfavors, if it is not suiting to the policy, then the scientists sometimes in democratic country will be in trouble. And I have seen through my eyes that how that scientist was, that scientist suffered that time. It was very unfortunate. So these GM crops, we really do not know. Many studies were stopped by Indian scientists because of such kind of pressure. Such kind of pressure on them, policy pressure on them. You have to work, so you have to report the things which suit to the policy. So there may be cases when diseases can happen in humans and animals. Just little later, I will show you how GM crops can cause diseases in human beings. And seed will remain with multinational companies. You know the story of cotton, BT cotton seed. It is mostly with the farm. With the multinational companies, and they are charging huge money to the farmers. And now in many products are in pipeline. They are not released in India, like golden rice, mustard, carrots. They are rich, carrots rich in calcium, somebody has developed. Tomatoes rich in antioxidants, biotic, abiotic stresses, and so on. I want to show you this case. And this was the research done by Sarah Linis, some France scientist from France. He found that cancer developed in rats due to GM crops. So what happened? He got some food. GM food means GM corn or maize, which was grown by having this glyphosate. So just I want to tell you that in GM crops, the most widely used is herbicide resistance. Herbicide resistance against the glyphosate. Glyphosate is a total killer. It is a herbicide which will kill weeds as well as crops. So it is a total killer herbicide. Glyphosate, it is known by the name Roundup. So what some companies have done, private multinational companies, that they have developed the crops like cotton, maize, and soybean, or some other crops, which can tolerate the high levels of this herbicide. They can tolerate double dose of these herbicides, and crop will not die. Only weeds will die. So those are called as herbicide-resistant maize, or cotton, or soybean, etc. So this, how they got this development, they took some bacteria. The name of the bacteria, maybe some name may be there, and they have taken a gene from that bacteria. And by putting that gene, this character came in the maize because that bacteria was not killed by this herbicide. So they have identified the gene which was responsible for that. Then they isolated the gene, and then that gene was put into the maize. So they made transgenic maize or GM maize or cotton, which was tolerant or resistant to herbicide. So now there may be three situations. One situation is that you just have GM maize. GM maize, you do not use any herbicide. In GM maize, number two situation can be that you grow GM maize and you also add herbicide, glyphosate. Third situation may be you grow the normal maize and put this herbicide. So this way you can know the effect of herbicide as well as effect of GM plant. So here in this picture, first three pictures, the top three pictures, see the first case, 9255, GMO. GMO means genetically modified. So here the corn or maize was GM maize, produced through GM maize, and they have taken the seed and they made the food of rats. They fed it to the rat and cancer was there. See number two, the central part, one, 9202R. Here the maize was normal. It was not the GM maize. Here the normal maize was treated with herbicide glyphosate. Again, only herbicide. It caused cancer. The third case, 9344, here, Karela neem chadha means it was bitter and it again got neem. So here, GM food was there and also Roundup. So when you combine GM food, so severity of cancer was too high. So you can see in all the three cases, cancer was there. So first message is that we should be very, very selective in using glyphosate or Roundup because it can lead to cancer. Second is GM crops also cause cancer. Third thing is that when you combine these two, the severity of cancer is very high. So these are the three conclusions from this paper. And what happened then, this paper went viral in the world. And many people who were involved with the multinational companies, they got worried that our market of so many billion dollars will be affected. If this research paper, this research continues to influence the brain of the people, then they will not eat GM food. So this study was deleted from the journal. It was published in some big journal, and then it was, in their language, they call it retracted, means wapas le liya gaya tha, retracted. So this study was retracted, and it was not just cancer. These materials affected their brains also. So you can see the tumors in their brains, I think. Their kidneys were also affected. You can see kidneys, liver, all these internal parts of rats were affected. So this study was published in Food Chemistry and Toxicology, which is a big journal. And later on, what they did, they removed the editor of this journal because that editor was adamant that I will not withdraw this study, it will remain as such. So the Monsanto company got the editor of this journal removed, and then the new editor came who may have been acceptable, and he deleted this study from the journal. But later on, one more journal published it. So these kind of things happen. Now see the story of this BT crop. Now destruction of cotton in Punjab by white fly. So white fly became the major pest. Okay, you can stop bollworms, this Pectinophora gossypiella, pink bollworm and spotted bollworm. I think these are the worms which used to damage this crop. Okay, they will not come because of BT gene. But now other insects have become the major pest, which were not known 20 years before, 30 years before. Now, for example, whitefly has emerged as an important insect. So, kitne insect ke khilaf aap BT cotton banaoge? How many insects? You kill 10, nature has 1,000. Some new insect will come. So, that is the problem with these kind of technologies. So, now you see genetically engineered crops, glyphosate, and deterioration of health in the United States of America. This is the very authentic data published from USDA, United States Department of Agriculture. They have taken all the authentic data And you can see this picture shows you adoption of GE crops in US. Genetically engineered. Here GE means engineered. So from this picture, I can say you can remember that in America, corn, soybean, and cotton, almost 100% area in these crops is occupied by GM crops. Just remember this, 100% area is GM area for soybean, corn, and cotton in America. And all these crops are almost 100% treated with glyphosate. Glyphosate is in common use in all these crops. And because of this, several diseases have suddenly appeared in America. Here, America means USA. Now you can see the use of glyphosate is linearly increasing in America. Pounds per acre. This is pounds per acre. This is not total consumption. Pounds per acre is increasing. This pesticide or herbicide use is increasing in America. And almost 100% of soybean, 100% of corn, and 100% of cotton are treated with this herbicide. And you see it started from somewhere around 1997 or 98, somewhere here, that sudden change is there. Now you see these are the, just I will try to explain you one picture. This picture shows that in year around, somewhere around 96, 97, they introduced,
sorry sir for interrupting. My data is about to end, sir.
So your data is okay. So what you will do, you just, when it ends, I will post it in my YouTube channel. So I want 10 minutes more. So if it is not working, then you don't worry. I'll put the same in my YouTube and then you can see there. Okay. Just give me 10 minutes. I want to finish it.
Okay,
so sir. It is fine. It is fine. But what about others? Can you bear 10 minutes more?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Fine. Now you see the GM crops came somewhere around 96, 97 here. And since then, there is sudden spurt in the diseases. See, in the x-axis, you have years. On y-axis, you have incidence of disease. So just you consider it as relative incidence of disease. So from 96 onward, up to 96, the change is very smooth. The change or increase is very smooth. Normal is smooth, normal increase. But after 96, you see sudden increase. Blue color and the red color, there is sudden increase. However, it could have been green, but it is not there. Instead of this green line, you see red and blue. So what I mean to say, because the consumption of BT crops, corn, soybean, started this time. Therefore, this paper blamed that these GM crops, because of the GM crops and herbicide, because you cannot separate their effect. Because of herbicide and GM crops combination, the number of diseased people increased in USA. This is the mess. So you can see this is one disease, liver cancer. Same story with another disease. So this may be some other disease, age-adjusted kidney renal disease. This is another disease, same trend. So what happened? I'll share this paper if you are interested. So a jury found that Monsanto's weed killer Roundup partly caused Edwin Hardenman's cancer. So some evidences have straightway blamed this Roundup, that this Roundup has caused cancer. It is a verdict of the jury. That means we have to believe it. We have to believe it. This Roundup can lead to cancer. So this is last slide, friend. And there are questions from the public and common people. Many times you have questions. See my case, I promote both farming. I promote organic farming. I can give lecture. I talk of organic farming. I do research on farming, organic farming. But I also do research on conventional farming, chemical farming. We are known for fertilizers, means we work on fertilizer. And this, our laboratory in agronomy division developed neem-coated urea. Many of you may not be knowing. that neem coated urea has been developed from division of agronomy in the world, I can say now. So what I mean to say that we are working on both conventional farming, organic farm. See, for example, a film star will work in all kind of movies. He will work in action movies, emotional movies, or all sorts of movies. A singer will sing all kind of song, sad song, happy song, fast song, slow song. So nothing is bad and nothing is perfect. So nothing is fully bad and nothing is fully perfect. There are some pluses and minuses in all kind of farm. There may be different versions of the farm. Some are pure organic, some are partly organic, some ICM, some integrated farming system, some have other combination of enterprises. One farmer may go for rice fish farming. So we have a lot of variability in the farming systems. So not one model is fit or suitable for one particular condition. So I usually say that in the sky, you have number of stars, variety of stars are there. So are the farming practices. So you can criticize it, you can appreciate it. And now people have interest. So there are two interests of the people. Some people have interest here means business interest. Business interest is there. Some have business interest in organic products. Some have business interest in inputs like your pesticides or machines. So they, according to their requirement, the way they want to earn money, they promote the things. These are my very personal observations and personal views. So, for example, now question is organic farming sustainable? So what is your view? Just 5 minutes more. I will stop at 6. So what is your view on is organic farming sustainable? Here, sustainable means can we get the yield or more yields, more production from organic farming? Can be better off or can we better the economics of the farmers or can we protect the environment? Yes, from organic farming can naturally be can be sustainable because in Indian context, we are not saying to convert whole area into organic farming, just part of it. Secondly, you have seen the principles of organic farming. Principles of organic farming all mostly talk of preservation of natural resources, preservation of biodiversity, and very normal use of, there is no exploitation of anybody. So overall, you can say organic farming is sustainable. It can sustain your food security also. And so on. I can discuss more or less incidence of insect pests and diseases. So naturally, I have seen myself made some observation, and we found that health of the plant is good. If you grow your plant by chemical fertilizers, then their growth is fast. There is no balanced nutrition of the plant. But in organic system, the nutrition of the plant is very balanced. It gets micronutrient, macronutrient, all kind of things are there. So normally the plants are healthy. Further, in organic system, you have microbes in the soil. So these microbes are in large number. You would agree, under organic system, the soil microbiology is better than the chemical farming. Here you get more microbial growth because of addition of large quantity of organic matter, number one, because of adoption of crop rotations or diversification in organic system, you get more microbial population under organic system. So soils are healthy. So healthy soil will produce more microbes. More microbes means more enzymes in the soil and more vitamins in the soil. You know, some microbes also produce vitamin into the soil. And they also release some amino acids, enzymes, and so on. And those are directly removed by the plant. So plant take up all those materials from the microbes, and then the immunity system of the plant becomes much better. So what I want to say here is that the plants are immune. Not immune, they are partly tolerant to many insect pests and diseases because of improved defense system, improved defense mechanism. Second, above ground biodiversity, you get crop rotations and diversification. So your friendly insects, friendly insects or biodiversity is more in organic system. Therefore, you get more population of friendly insects and the natural insect pest and disease management is there. So this is how overall under organic system, comparatively, there is less incidence of insect pest and disease because of improved soil health and improved above ground biodiversity. And if at all they are there, one can use biopesticides. Number of options are available for biopesticides or certain extract of neem and other, they are in large numbers now in the market. They can be used to manage the insect pest and disease. One thing I want to tell you here, that there is one study that bats, B-A-T-S, bats, chamgadar, bats is an flying animal, you know, bat, chamgadar. So it eats insect. So population of bats was found more on organic farm compared to conventional farm because of biodiversity. If you get bats in your farm, on your farm, that means you have more biodiversity at your farm compared to other farm. So how about product quality? I have already shown you that a lot of pesticides are there and your product quality is declined. I'll take up it again, quality of the product. Why fertilizers are not allowed? Remember two reasons. Number one is that production of fertilizer produces pollution. When you produce fertilizer, when in any fertilizer production, you need to consume energy. For example, if you produce urea, you need to combine nitrogen and hydrogen in 1:3 ratio. That means that requires about 1200 degree centigrade temperature. That means you are consuming energy or electricity. If you consume electricity, it is produced by creating pollution. You need to burn the coal or fuel. Then you get electricity. Means in the production of fertilizer, you consume energy. Energy consumption generally means you are creating pollution. So production of fertilizer creates pollution. And secondly, the excessive use of fertilizer also creates pollution. For example, nitrogenous fertilizer can be volatilized, denitrification, or leaching. Phosphatic fertilizer, surface runoff, etc. So fertilizer in any case is polluting the environment. So therefore, use of fertilizer is not allowed because otherwise fertilizers are not really poison. They are food of the plant, but is still not allowed due to pollution issue. And second issue is if you make their excess use in the soil, they affect the microbiology of the soil. The microbes which are staying in the soil, they will become lazy. They will not like to work if they get easy food. Easy food means from fertilizer, they can get nitrate or other kind of food. So therefore, due to three reasons, fertilizers are not allowed. Plant does not discriminate whether nitrogen has come from organic source or inorganic source. Ultimately, nitrogen has to be converted into ammonium and nitrate for plant uptake. So it really does not matter. But people forget that if we supply this nitrate by urea, then we are creating the pollution. This is one. Second, evidences have come up where organic nutrition, amino acid can be directly absorbed by the plant. So I will take up one lecture on organic plant nutrition where you will see how this how plant can take up nutrients in organic form, not in ionic form. Next is GM crops not allowed. I have discussed anti-nature. They are good. No, they are not good for soil health, not good for human health. Can organic farming help to mitigate climate change effects? Of course, yes. Answer is yes. Organic farming will result in increased carbon sequestration in the soil, reduced use of fertilizers, and reduced pollution. It can be explained very easily. And one thing is that when you adopt organic farming, your water holding capacity of the soil increases because of increased organic matter content in the soil. So increased organic matter content in the soil results in improved soil structure, and this results in improved water holding capacity of the soil. So therefore, if you follow organic farming, you will need less water. Suppose under conventional farming, you require 5 irrigation in the same kind of soil. In organic, you will need 4 irrigation because water storage capacity is more, losses of water are more. So water is also related to environment. water and all these gases or air, they are environmental issues. So we can save the water also through organic farming. So that ends this lecture here. Recording can be stopped. I can request to stop the recording.